positive territory right now, up by 1% to 65.28, above the 65 resistance level. The broader all shares index is higher by 0.9% to 39.89. The market's advance is broad-based. All the sub-indices are trading in the green, with the mining oil counter up the most. Right now it's up by 2.24%. Trading, though, is thin. Value turnover stands at 329 million pesos. Market breadth is positive, with 75 advancers, 25 decliners, and 24 stocks unchanged. Now, with me right now is Richard this is a bit of a tongue twister, McGillivray. He's the Industry Relations Director for the CFA Institute of Asia Pacific. He's here to talk to us about his organization and the merits of joining it.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, good morning. Thanks for being here. Okay, Richard, so you're a global community of investment professionals. Can you tell us what it is you do and why people in the finance industry should be a part of CFA?
Sure. Okay, so we are an association, and we're a not-for-profit organization. We are also mission-based, so we are focused on fostering a financial services and investment industry that serves the greater good. So that is broadly the mission. The tools of the mission are essentially three programs. Two of them are designations. The most well-known of those is essentially our CFA charter.
How big is the community globally and in the Philippines?
There are just over 100,000 charterholders, CFA charterholders globally. Around 130 in the Philippines, and our Philippine society, which has been active for some time here, tells me that one of the issues is that people who gain the charter here become quite mobile. So, you know, they gain the charter and they move to jobs abroad, which has typically happened. I think with the changes in the performance of the Philippines economy and the growth of the banking sector here in particular, I think that's something that may change.
Okay, can you tell us about being a CFA charter holder? It's not a degree, it's not a diploma. Can you tell us more about it?
Sure.
It's likened to having an MBA.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's best described as, it's training in two ways. It's an analytic program, so it is about calculations, about the analysis of investment opportunity. So it has in effect become the global standard of investment professionals. So in many instances, we see increasingly firms employing investment professionals requiring a CFA charter. The program itself has three levels. It is extremely rigorous. I think it's fair to say it's quite tough. It has 1,000 hours of study, approximately 18 hours of examinations. It's not something that's likely taken.
And as you mentioned earlier, once you have it, you become much more attractive to jobs abroad.
Yeah, and I think that, and the reasons for that are twofold. I think it functionally provides you with the tools to fulfill those roles. I think it makes a statement to employers about the kind of person you are in terms of your abilities and your commitment to rigor. And of course, you've been ethically trained as well. So that's
important. These are global standards.
Correct, yes. Okay. So they're certainly globally recognized.
All right, so how long has this institution been around for?
Yeah. For some time now. It goes back to 1947, the charter itself back to 1953. So it is a program that has grown, and both in terms of depth and breadth. And I think that part of it is the recognition of the quality that the organization brings. So its connections to academic roots, the kind of standards that it upholds, and again, its mission, which is essentially about raising professional and ethical standards. So,
and in the Philippines, you've been here for about 15 years.
That's
about
correct.
130 CFA charter holders locally.
That's correct, yes. And many more registrants at the moment. Again, I think the issue of mobility will continue to face people in the Philippines. But I mean, a couple of things that are worth noting, that the Philippine society, so the CFA society here, has been active here for 15 years. It is a very globally respected society. It certainly punches above its weight numerically. An example would be we run a global investment research challenge on an annual basis, and the Philippines won that in 2010. And in fact, the coach of that team is here with me today. So in essence,
it speaks of the quality of the people that we produce towards this profession.
Absolutely.
So if you're an investor, look for someone with a CFA charter holder.
I would say that is a fair thing to say, yes.
Okay. What should we look for if we are to look for someone with a CFA? Credentials. When we're looking for someone to invest our money, what sort of person are we looking for?
Well, I think, I can answer this personally, okay?
Yes, I don't
speak for anyone else on this. Certainly you would look for people who are disciplined, highly analytical, ethical, well-trained with a decent track record. And I think that typically you will find a lot of charter holders fit that.
And with a charter holder of the different levels, it just speaks volumes of how many hours they've put into it. Can you talk to us about the length of study for each level of the CFA, of the three levels?
Well, as I say, I mean, you know, collectively it breaks down at about 1,000 hours for the whole journey. And, you know, just to be clear, you know, that may not sound like a significant commitment, but it's a very significant commitment. Not only is it about volume, but the level at which, you know, the program is run is extremely high. The pass rate is quite low because our standard setting process is very rigorous. So we're very clear as an institution what it is that investment professionals need to know and be able to do. So the standards are set by that rather than us chasing a particular pass
rate.
And
what's the examination like? I know it's quite extensive.
Yeah, the examination is a blend in the early levels of multiple choice, but also theoretical essay type questions later on. You know, the questions are scenario based. It is certainly intellectually challenging. I think charter holders themselves make a statement about their abilities.
Okay. For those that aren't investment decision makers but would like to gain more knowledge in this, you also have another program, the certificate program, which is Claritas. This is the first time that you have a certificate program. Can you tell us more about this?
Sure. Well, Claritas is a new program. We launched it this year, so it's our first generalist program in 50 years. So we're very excited about it. It comes out of an industry need, so a push from leaders in the industry saying that, you know, we focused on investment professionals in the wake of the global financial crisis. I think there's strong recognition of the need for broad-based, comprehensive, practical and ethical training for the many people who support investment professionals. And, you know, we think that's around a 1-to-10 ratio. So we're looking at people who work in the front office of financial services businesses and the middle and the back office. So we have a global program, it's comprehensive, it brings clarity to complexity, it develops shared knowledge. We believe it improves people's performance and makes them more competitive in a competitive industry.
What are the entry requirements to get into this program?
There are no entry requirements to get into Claritas, so I'd encourage people to visit the website and have a look at the program. I think two key issues that I should alert people to is that it's approximately 100 hours of self-study, so it's delivered through an ebook, so it's very accessible to people all over. They don't need to access centers and resources. The examinations are run by our examining partner, Pearson View, and they're not block examinations. There's a flexible booking system, so we've really worked very hard at making this accessible to people, and it's a big part of our achievement of our mission to build professional and ethical standards. So we are focusing on people who work around those investment professionals with it.
So it's a self-study way to broaden your knowledge base in this industry.
Absolutely. So to be clear, it looks at all the moving parts of the financial services industry, how they fit together, what the relationship between them is, what the roles, responsibilities, and accountabilities and ethical standards in each of those are, and how they apply to investor protection. So I think it's, you know, it's a very important part of rebuilding trust in the industry, I think,
right.
Which is a
and it's a great
thing.
It's a great program because now there's a different, a lighter avenue for people if they want to be part of the CFA Institute.
Sure, absolutely. In fact, on our global pilot program, which we concluded earlier this year, one of the main piece of feedback we got as a valuing of the program, the first response was that participants felt that it broadened the industry knowledge most deeply. They valued that the most. Second most, I think, was they valued the association with the CFA Institute and the kind of support that brings with it.
Well, thank you for sharing your time with us this morning, Richard.
Thank you for having me.
And at the foreign exchange market, as of 10:10 this morning, the peso has reached a weighted average of 43.441. This is on volume worth $196 million. Now, Ron, over to you for some more news.
Thanks, Mikey. Marago consumers should brace for higher electricity bills.